This is the goat walk near Topsham, making this the top end of the nearly 6 mile long Exe estuary.
The trouble is getting the tides right. With 2 to 3 hours either side of a high tide being ideal. Otherwise, the birds are right out there, or they're somewhere else. What you really need is a TTT, a tide time table. So according to this today, at this time, the tide should be out. Oh look, the tide's out. Hey, it works.
Like the other mudflat areas, here it's a haven for wading birds. The attraction being that each square metre of mud has the calorie equivalent of 14 Mars bars. Well, if you're a wading bird, that is. Along with the godwits with their long straight bills and the curlews with their downward curved bills, there are the usual little egrets. And then there are the avocets. However, if you miss the tide, all is not lost, as the birds move across to different reserves, such as here at Bowling Green Marsh. As you can see here, the curlews and godwits have already made their way here, along with the common sandpiper. Canada geese, the teal with their distinct markings, a selection of ducks, and oh, a fox, probably hoping for a duck. Exeter itself had been a thriving port until it faced serious competition from Topsham, Weirs and Quay. By the time permission had been granted to reopen the access to Exeter, the river had silted up, making it necessary to build a canal instead.
This is what remains of the 5 mile long Exeter Ship Canal, which was once big enough to take ocean going vessels, as its name suggests.
In the late 1700s, the Exeter Ship Canal was caught up in plans to link the Bristol and English channels. And believe me, the ideas were many and varied. But the one that came closest to completion was between here and Bridgewater Bay. But first, I'm off to see something rather special. Thank you. The village of Cheddar is well known for its caves and its cheese. But in recent years, it's become rather well known for this place.
This is the mill pond at Cheddar, and it's the place to come if you want to see water voles. There's even a notice about them. One of the locals told me he saw six. Well, I'd be happy just seeing one. This apparently is the best place to see them, in the ivy. They actually nest above the ivy on the bank, and they use the ivy as a kind of climbing frame to get to and from the water. There's one over there, in fact.
These cute little critters are sometimes referred to as water rats, although there is no physical resemblance. Water voles have a special flap of skin in the ear to keep out the water when they dive below the surface. They have quite a busy breeding season, with an average of 4 litters of 3 to 9 babies between March and September, and yet they are the UK's fastest declining mammal. Although habitat loss is a problem, the biggest threat comes from the mink. Unlike their usual predators of weasels, stoats, foxes and herons, mink can swim underwater, and the female mink is small enough to access the burrow and reach the young.
The Brew Estuary here at Burnham-on-Sea is part of the more accessible stretch of Bridgewater Bay. With the right tide, it's possible to cycle along the beach all the way to Breen Down. Like its neighbour, the River Parrot, it is often used by wading birds or forced off the bay by the rising tide. The name Burnham-on-Sea comes from the old English words Burner, which means stream, and Ham, with two M's, which means enclosure. And the on-sea bit, well, that came later. What's unusual is its lighthouse, or rather lighthouses, because there were three. Now, that reminds me of a story. In the mid-1700s, in a cottage by this church, an old fisherman's wife was waiting, worried for her husband's return after dark. So she lit a candle and placed it in the window. Her husband was safe, and the other sailors were so grateful they paid her a levy to continue the service. The local sexton then paid her £5 for the rights to the levy and put his light in the church, which was obviously taller.
Seeing the financial advantage, the curate built the round tower and paid £20 for the rights to the light. Eventually, they built a proper lighthouse, and the round tower was lowered to avoid confusion. But despite being nearly 100 feet tall, there was a spot of bother when the tide went out. You couldn't see it. So they built a smaller structure on the beach, and the two worked together for many years. The tall lighthouse is now the only lighthouse in England that's a holiday home, if you're super fit. The remaining lighthouse is still in use today. So Burnham-on-Sea is one of the few places in England that boasts three lighthouses. Which one's your favourite?